Two sites today for the surge testing that we talked about yesterday. It's just unbelievable the response that we've seen. You know, as of this morning, 3,600 people signed up on the website, and of course others are showing up. And we have issues on logistics, but the good news is people are getting tested in numbers like never before. Before I go with my own comments, you know, we're very lucky again to have the Surgeon General of the United States here dedicating a number of days to the city and county of Honolulu to help us with our high number of COVID-19 cases. And we couldn't do this surge testing effort without the cooperation, the support, and everything else from the Surgeon General of the United States, Surgeon General Adams. So we'd like him to say a few words. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you for coming out. I want to thank Leeward College and Chancellor Penalotha for hosting this site. I want to thank the people of Hawaii for their tremendous response so far in signing up at doineedacovid19test.com. And you can tell from the line out here that people are embracing our call to come and get tested. Testing is free. You don't need a doctor's order. And we're going to be doing this for 14 days. So I want everyone across the island to come out and get tested. Of course, there are people who are concerned about the lines, and I want to acknowledge that. I want you to know that we will be here for at least 14 days. So if you have symptoms or if you've been around someone who has COVID-19, call your health professional. You still can get tested through that route, or sign up right away to get tested. If you're someone who just wants to know your status, then know that we will continue to look at different sites, different places, and make sure we improve throughput. But for today, I consider this a success in terms of people's interest and the number of folks who've already signed up, and we want to continue to see this enthusiasm build over the next 14 days so we can get to our goal of 70,000 tests. Today, I went to Queens Medical Center. Yesterday, I was at Hawaii Pacific, learning about the care of people with COVID here on the island. People are getting excellent care, but I want you to know that one of the reasons really support the mayor and the governor and the lieutenant governor and the health department with this two-week stay-at-home order is because we are seeing cases continue to go up. We're seeing positivity continue to go up. Positivity is the number of tests that come back positive. And Hawaii was well under 5%, which we consider in the green for most of 2020. I decided to come out here because Hawaii was in the yellow. When you look at the testing rates for the last 24 hours, and I reviewed them with the lieutenant governor this morning, you're over 10%, which puts Hawaii in the red. And so we don't want to overwhelm our health system capacity. We want to make sure people who get sick can get a bed, can get medicine, can get a ventilator if they need it. And that's why we're calling on all of you to be to cooperate with the stay-at-home order and to practice the 3 W's. Wash your hands, watch your distance, meaning avoid crowded indoor spaces, even amongst your families, and to wear a face mask when you go out in public. If we do these things, we can level off cases, we can turn things around, and in 2 weeks, hopefully we can get to a place where we can reopen once again in a more controlled and cautious fashion and stay open until we get a vaccine and get back to a place where more people would consider it closer to normal. But again, come out and get tested. Do I need a COVID-19 test.com over the next 14 days. If you have symptoms, we want you to prioritize getting testing right away through your health professional or through these locations. If you don't have symptoms, then you can wait a day or two, or you can find a site that's going to be coming near you, because we'll continue to improve this process and make it easier for you. With that, I'll turn it back over to the mayor, and then we'll take questions.
So as a Surgeon General urged, we really want as many people to come out and be tested. We'd love to see entire families come with your bubble, whether it's your blood relatives, your ohana, or your roommates. Please come, all of you, and get tested. It's not an invasive test. It is a swab test. And after the test, you do not have to quarantine. unless you come back positive, then absolutely you must quarantine. This is really critical as part of our stay-at-home, work-at-home efforts. As we shut down for 2 weeks and as we test during these 2 weeks, we find out where COVID-19 is and where it isn't, and we know better on how to attack it and how to contact trace and how to isolate, which is why we talk about three legs of a stool. This is the first leg. The second leg is the contact tracing. And we've asked the governor for the authority. We have to get permission from the Department of Health to actually hire more contact tracers. They gave us permission last week for 10. Not many. We want somewhere between 250 to 500 to supplement what the state is doing and to work with Department of Health in terms of the information we get from contact tracing and feeding it into their system so we know where the virus is and what we need to do. And then finally, as we talk about quarantining, we talked about the hotel in Waikiki we signed on with last week. We're looking at two other hotels. We don't want to say we have thousands of hotel rooms right now, but we're going to be looking for rooms and adding them as the demand is there for greater capacity because we have to quarantine folks. We need to do this, and we need to particularly focus in the Pacific Islander community and in the Filipino-American community in places like Kalihi. We need to do this if we're going to control the spread of this virus. As you saw today, the numbers were disappointing. Way too high still. Not as the highest ever, but up there. So all the things we've done so far have not brought down the numbers. And so the stay-at-home, work-at-home order is a way to do that. And I know there is a lot of pain and suffering that we're causing, unfortunately. And we're drawing some very bright lines of what has to happen and how to enforce. And I know sometimes people don't even think, why are public schools open, now private schools are closed? If I had it my way, I'd close all schools for 2 weeks. People stay at home, work at home, learn at home as much as possible. But we don't live in the perfect, we live in the good. And I think what we're doing is good and is going to make a difference. So I want to thank everyone for their understanding and living with the requirements that we placed on them. I do want to thank Carlos Penalosa, the Chancellor of Leeward Community College, for allowing this to happen. It does create disruption, but it does also say we're all in this together. One team, one Oahu, one strong, federal, state, and county. The governor wanted to be here today, but after the VTC, he went on to other things. But again, we need the state. We're working closely with the governor on all levels to make sure we can test, trace, and quarantine. With that, I'll open up to any and all questions you may have. The Surgeon General has to leave around 1, and I want to apologize yesterday when we kind of cut you guys off because he had to leave. He also ended on a high note of hope. And for me, all of this is about hope. So we want you to be able to ask as many as you can questions you can ask for the next 15 minutes or so of the Surgeon General. I am willing to stay longer to answer questions, but we'll go with him, and perhaps you ask him all the questions you have that he can answer, and then I'll stick around to answer other questions you may have, if that's okay with all of you. Okay, with that, I'm going to turn it back to the Surgeon General, and we're going to start with Allison. Surgeon General.
So we talked about people being turned away from the testing site. I don't have visibility on that personally. What I can tell people is that, again, that's the reason why we're doing this for 14 days and not one day. It takes a lot to stand up these testing sites, logistically speaking, to make sure you have supplies, to make sure you have people. And again, I consider it a success that so many people across the island have embraced the idea of testing and wanted to come in and get testing. So what I would say to the people here is do something that we know you all are famous for, especially compared to mainlanders like myself, and that's be patient and understand that we will work through this and we'll continue to improve some of the kinks in the system so that we can deliver a better testing experience to each and every one of you. And speaking of testing experience, I want to show you all what the testing looks like. You'll come to the site. I'll do it myself. Okay. Because it's a self-swab. So when you sign up, you'll come to a testing site. They will confirm that it is you, and then they'll hand you a bag that will have a specimen container or a vial and a swab in it. This is what the swab actually looks like, but only the very tip is what goes into your nostril. So they'll tell you to put it in your nostril, just the tip, and turn it around 5 times on one side. You'll put it in the other nostril, turn it around 5 times. You'll open up your vial, put it in, break it off, cover it up, and then you'll give the vial back to the people, and you'll get your results via email in about 2 to 3 days. So again, easy to do. Please be patient with us. Please register online, because that makes it easier for everyone. And again, we're well on our way to the goal of making sure we get 70,000 tests in 14 days. Well, I think that it's a challenge that everyone across the nation is dealing with. This virus is highly contagious, and we can't treat it like a light switch when we reopen. We need to understand that when we reopen, you have to do it cautiously, and the state has green, yellow, orange, and red indicators, and I think people wanted to go from one extreme to the other and not realize that we have to have a cautious reopening, and that many of us still need to understand that we are safer at home even when we get to a place where we don't have a stay-at-home order anymore. I think it's important that everyone embraces the 3 W's: wearing a mask, washing your hands, and most importantly, watching your distance. And we also know that in the Hawaii and Pacific Islander culture, people enjoy being together. They enjoy being close. So it's important to know that as we're dealing with this virus, you need to decrease the size of your bubble. You need to understand that every person who comes in and out of your bubble is a person who could be spreading virus or who you could be spreading virus to. I want us to think of this next 2 weeks as not a time of pain, but as a time to hit the reset button so that we can more cautiously reopen when the time is appropriate and when those positivity rates start to come back down. And I'm confident that Hawaii can be successful again. Again, you had most of 2020 with low positivity rates and having a lot more freedom than the rest of the United States did. So I want you to remember that. I want you to remember that, and I want you to understand we can get there again if everyone does their part.
Can I just add? Please. Alice has two questions. For one, on people being turned away, it's correct. Over in Kanehoe, we did shut down for a short period of time, about a half an hour to 45 minutes, to get control and to allow people to get back in line and not cause more gridlock and traffic. It's now opened again, and they called and said, would I be okay with it? And I said, as long as you're managing traffic, we want to make sure that people's health and safety is protected as they come into the site. But it led me to the next thing, which is I called out to Governor Ige and asked, could we use Aloha Stadium? As you know, with food distribution, we found that to be the most ideal site because of the size of entrance, a lot of different entrances and exits, and a lot of space. And he said, absolutely, we're on board. If you need a stadium for the next 11 days to 12, 14 days, we'll make it available. So we're working on the logistics. That will be one of the sites, to your question. Number two, you know, I asked myself as mayor, you know, we're down at days of zero cases and a population of 1 million. But then I look at South Korea, they were the shining star, and yet now they have a lockdown going on. New Zealand, another shining star, and now a lockdown. And this is repeated in many different countries around the world and in forward-leaning cities. And what it tells me and what it should tell all of us is this virus lives. It travels among us as we travel and communicate and go about our business. And as the Surgeon General says, it's living with the virus. It's important. Getting rid of it at zero until we have a vaccine is difficult. So what do we do to live with the virus? And it's being a little bit more careful than what we were as we opened up. And as we reopen, we're going to have to reset that too in terms of the amount of caution we put in place so we don't have to shut down a third time. That to me would be a definition of insanity. So just know that other cities like ours who were at zero have seen a resurgence because people became lax. and other protocols weren't in place that we're putting in, which is surge testing, contact tracing, and isolation. More questions for the Surgeon General.
So the question was about contact tracing, and I'll let the mayor talk about what they're doing from the city point of view in concert with the state government. But it's important to understand that there are different phases of viral spread. For different viruses, whether it's measles or the flu or COVID-19, when we have a small number of cases, we can test someone, find out they're positive. We can contact trace, which is figuring out who else they've been around. And then we can isolate sick individuals and quarantine individuals who've been exposed. So that's the process for stopping viral spread. That works when you have smaller amounts of virus spread, because each person, on average, knows 600 other people. It's not that they're always in contact with them, but it takes a certain bit of manpower. Your question was about how many contact tracers do we need, and that depends on how much the virus is spreading. And right now, I'm concerned that that Hawaii is in the red for the day and the yellow for the last several days in terms of positivity rates, and steady state in terms of new cases at a pretty high rate, which makes it difficult to contact trace. That doesn't mean that we're still not going to try to do it, particularly for high risk contacts, but it's incumbent upon the people of Hawaii to do their part to help us lower positivity, lower new cases, so that we can more effectively contact trace. And again, we anticipate that for an island of this size, you would need somewhere between a few hundred to 300 or 400 people at the positivity rates that we have right now. And unfortunately, that's difficult to get, because you don't have a large pool of people out there who can go out there and do this. We're actively recruiting. We're training people to contact trace, but it's important to understand that connectivity between the positivity rate in new cases and the number of contact tracers you need. And the whole idea behind the 2 weeks is to decrease the caseload, decrease the positivity, so we can more adequately handle it with the testing and the contact tracing that we have available. That's why the surge testing that we're doing right now is so important too, though, so we can get visibility on where these cases are occurring, because we know a lot of people are spreading this this virus without symptoms, without having a cough, a fever, a runny nose, and knowing it. And if we can help people understand the communities where this spread is occurring, then we know that people will change their behaviors accordingly. Mayor, anything you'd add?
Well, I'd agree with the Surgeon General in terms of number of tracers. As you know, both Harvard and Johns Hopkins have recommended for a population of our size, about 1 million people, you need somewhere between 350 to 450 contact tracers. For the state of Hawaii, somewhere around 500. We're nowhere near that. And we do need to build our capacity, and we want to be part of the solution. We don't want to complain or blame at this point. It's what do we do? And so with the Department of Health giving us the authority to hire contact tracers, we know we can hire them. We do know that UH has trained folks. We've been told that a lot of them do not want to work full-time, just part-time. And we're also looking at other potential options. Could you work with call centers? You know, guys who make calls for either it's for polling on all kinds of things. They're trained to go down lists and make calls and add up data and put it together and submit it every day. And perhaps that's another out-of-the-box way of looking at it. So we're going to explore all options to expand this capacity. Every contact tracer we get is one step to a different outcome than what we've had in the past.
So the question was about the new CDC testing guidelines. Number one, remember they are guidelines. Number two, it's important to understand that there's a lot of misinformation out there about what the CDC put out. It's really designed to help local health departments, state health departments, and states understand who should be prioritized for testing. It's not to say that people shouldn't get tested. It's to say that we should make sure we prioritize, first and foremost, those people who have symptoms or who have had a high-risk exposure. What we've done from the task force perspective is look at places across the United States that are either in the yellow or the red for positivity, understanding that those places we need to do more than just diagnostic testing of symptomatic people. We need to make sure we're testing everyone, including people without symptoms, so that we understand where the disease is and it can better guide our interventions to break the spread of disease. So one of the things that we've talked about with the mayor and with the governor over the last several days, and they're in alignment on, is making sure everyone who absolutely needs a test because they have symptoms, first and foremost, can get it. But number two, making sure we have a strategic surveillance strategy so that even after this surge testing is over, we can make sure we're testing an appropriate number of people without symptoms to understand what the disease is doing and where it's spreading. So again, diagnostic testing and surveillance testing are two different things. We want to make sure we can always do diagnostic testing. We want to make sure we're smart and strategic about our surveillance testing when we're in the green. When we're in the yellow and the red, as Hawaii is right now, we want to make sure we're getting as much visibility as possible on what the virus is doing, which is why we have the surge testing site. Anyone can get tested. Sign up at doineedacovid19test.com. What I want to say to the folks on the island and the folks of Oahu is that right now you're in still a better place than many of the other hot spots around the country and around the nation have been. When you look at Arizona, when you look at Florida, when you look at Texas. And so we're here, we're sending a surge testing team and a craft team, which will look at what's going on around the city in the state. We'll make recommendations on best practices, and we'll be able to assess whether or not the stay-at-home order is being effective. Here's what I know. I know a lot of places around the country have been able to get their rates down with measures that are along the lines of what are being done here, or even a little bit less if you can get enough cooperation from the community to do their part. So this can work with what we've got going on right now, if people do their part, and if we continue to see what I've seen in the time I've been here, and that's great cooperation between the mayor and the governor and the state health department and the fire department and people within the community. These tests that we're doing here are PCR tests. They'll be sent to the mainland, to California, to be run on machines that have been approved by the FDA. The accuracy, the sensitivity of these tests is greater than 90%. Even when we do the nary swab, that's been shown by the CDC. And so we want people to understand these tests are highly accurate. But if you get a positive test result, we will make sure you follow up appropriately so that we can isolate and quarantine. And if we feel a follow-up test is warranted, then your healthcare provider will recommend that. If you're someone who has symptoms, a cough, a fever, a runny nose, and you come and you get a negative test, it's important to understand that even if you don't have COVID, you probably still have an infectious disease, and you still probably should stay home and stay away from other people. So at the end of the day, we want you to come. It'll give us better visibility on where the virus is spreading. If you test positive, listen to your health provider. If you test negative and you have symptoms, that still doesn't mean that you shouldn't do the basic public health measures we've been recommending, the 3 W's, wear a mask, wash your hands, and watch your distance. The change in the CDC guidance does not affect the testing plan here at all. And I want people to understand the CDC guidance is designed for people who are in a different place than what Hawaii is right now. It's designed to guide strategic testing in places where you're in the green or you're in the low yellow in terms of positivity. Hawaii is in the high yellow to red areas, and in those situations, the CDC guidance actually says that you should listen to your local health department and health providers in terms of who should be tested, and that asymptomatic testing in those scenarios is perfectly appropriate and advisable if the health department feels so. And in concert with the health department, we have decided we're going to do surge testing. Anyone, regardless of symptoms, can come out and get tested over the next 14 days. Well, one of the things that, again, our craft team sent by the federal government, and you're going to get two craft teams, which is more than most other states have gotten. They're going to be here for 2 weeks because we realize the difficulties of going back and forth across the mainland and to Hawaii as compared to about 1 week that the craft teams spend in other places. We're going to look at everything. We're going to look at testing. We're going to look at contact tracing. We're going to look at communities that have been hard hit. We know the Filipino community has been hard hit. We know that the Pacific Island community has been hard hit. And then we're going to make recommendations about how Hawaii can be in the best possible position to lower spread. So I can't guarantee anything 100% because, again, we've got humans involved here. I ask people to be patient, to understand that we are doing our best from a federal point of view, and I actually feel confident after the last several days that you have a high degree of alignment between the state and the federal and the local entities, the mayor, the governor, and the White House task force on this issue to make sure that we can get you through this shutdown. This stay-at-home order as quickly as possible and with as few people ending up in the hospital and dying as possible. But we need you. We need you to do your part. We need everyone to, again, stay at home, avoid gatherings, even amongst families, large gatherings over the next 2 weeks. Take this seriously so that we can reopen successfully. And I just want to thank everyone again for coming out today. Do I need a COVID-19 test.com, and I include all of you in the media in that. Get a COVID-19 test. Sign up. Tell people about your experience. Help them understand what you had to go through. Tell them about the nary swab so that more people will feel comfortable coming out and getting tested, and we can get visibility on this virus and get a handle on it. I'm confident we can get through this together. The news seems dire. It seems bad. But I tell you, it's better to intervene early. We know this in public health than to intervene late. And if you intervene early and aggressively, as the mayor and the governor are doing, then we can stop this virus in its tracks, and we can reopen sooner, we can reopen more safely, and we can reopen in a more sustained fashion until we get through to getting a virus. Final pitch, because I'm the Surgeon General and I wouldn't be doing my job if I didn't say this, get your flu shot this year. It's the most important flu season we're going to have in a long time. We don't want our healthcare system overwhelmed with people who have flu and preventing us from being able to treat COVID. We don't want to confuse the testing with people who have flu. And so you all have a responsibility to yourselves, your families, and your communities to get a flu shot this year so that you, again, can help slow the spread of both flu and help us better respond to COVID-19 in the community. And I want to give a shout out to our fire department and to our police department who are helping make this possible, again, along with the folks here at the college who've made this possible, and to everyone around the state who are hosting testing sites, because, again, truly Hawaii is stronger together, and we're seeing that today. Mayor?
Thank you. Surgeon General Adams, I wish you didn't have to leave now. I wish you didn't have to leave. We'd like to keep you until we get a handle on this pandemic and have a vaccine, but we want to thank you for all the aloha you've shown to us.
Thank you.
In the city and county of Honolulu. You really have shown an aloha that we usually don't see coming out of Washington. We want to thank you so much.
Thank you. And the one other thing I would say is that my family and I were supposed to come here for spring break this year. My 16, 14, and 10-year-old have never been to Hawaii, and they were really looking forward to it. They were really disappointed, but it's what we had to do. We had to pull down the trip because of COVID-19. We all make sacrifices. I'm asking the people of Hawaii so that my kids don't kill me. Please do your part so we can safely reopen. And by spring break of next year, I can be back here on the beaches with you, enjoying this beautiful, this lovely state. I just want you to know how much I love Hawaii. I've been to Molokai. I've been to Waianae. I've been around the island. I'm a rural kid myself who grew up on a farm. And as much as I love being in downtown Waikiki, I feel at home when I get out to the farms, to the pineapple farms, and seeing the fresh fruit grown all across the island. And I want you to know you are strong, you're resilient, and you will get through this. Don't look at this 2 weeks as something bad. Look at it as an opportunity that we've been given to really reassess the situation, get it under control, and to safely reopen. And I want to thank the mayor for the hospitality, and to know that I'm here for you and for the people of Hawaii. We will get through this together. Thank you.
Thank you so much. We'll be talking again.
Thanks, sir.
Take care.
Take care.
I did want to follow up on one of the questions. I don't know if it was Allison asked it, but they said, you know, how do you follow up on positives and negatives? And people have said they've not been contacted quickly. Part of the beauty of the surge testing program brought to us by the federal government is that people go online and fill out a form in order to get the test, for the most part. And so the notice is going to be given to them online, both the negatives and the positives. So it's not as driven by manpower, woman power, people power, making calls. It's just you get the notification. But there are people who don't have access to the internet, that don't have cell phones or laptops to go online. And so we are instituting a process where they can register off of portable iPads that we have, and the notice is being given to other folks to give to them. So we're trying to cover every base. It may not be perfect in every situation, but it's going to be better than the existing system, which requires phone calls from people. So we appreciate it. We're going to see how it works, and as we go, we'll improve on it. Well, for sure, whoever doesn't get a test, and I assume that given the lines today, not everyone is going to get a test. We want them to come back tomorrow at the next locations, and we need to do a better job in terms of, you know, traffic flow and getting more people in to be tested, working with our federal partners in terms of watching who is doing the swabbing. As far as whether they'll stay open beyond two, I mean, Alex, I don't know if you can find out whether they'll stay beyond two. If it was my choice, I'd like them to stay open longer. But I don't know what the agreement is with the federal folks that stand here, right? They're actually monitoring how the swabbing is being done. And I don't know if they will stay beyond 2 o'clock. Alex, you're gonna what?
We're gonna check on that.
Okay, but if you can, ask them and then find out how much longer. Thanks.
That last check, the stay-at-home order had not been signed.
So the stay-at-home order was actually sent a while ago. It's gotten some modifications. As I mentioned, I would have shut all schools, both public and private. All private schools are shut, will be shut, effective midnight tonight. This morning we got more requests from Department of Health that were not discussed previously. And for the most part, we have disagreement on some of those recommendations, and so we've responded, and the ball is now in their court. But to try to get the information out to all of you through the media, we have released the order that was sent to the governor, where we thought we had agreement on, so people know what's in there. And for the most part, it looks very similar to the March order in broad sections. The one exception is spiritual gatherings. You know, you can now gather where before you couldn't, with all the protocols and mandates in place. You know, my read of the order is I think there is a distinction between the public and private schools. And in fact, it was a carve out for the public schools. So I'll go back and read it again. But the way I read it and the way talking to our lawyers, they say there is a distinction. So that is correct. We really want people to stay at home, work at home, do distance learning from home, and not being on campus. You know, essential workers are allowed on a campus to keep things functioning, but students should not be on campus to go to do schoolwork during this period of time. They should do it long distance, over the internet, and other ways.
So, Mayor, what? For the testing,
So the question was asked about testing, which was going to end at 2. It's now they've agreed to keep it open till 4, but you will get your results a day later because we need to get all test results over to FedEx. They send it off to the lab in California because we didn't want to tax our local labs. This is all a part adding capacity, not diminishing capacity. And so it'll be another day because we won't make it to the FedEx plane in time. So I did ask the governor for the authority or the permission to use Aloha Stadium for the remaining days of testing. Whether we go there every day will be up to the incident command led by the Honolulu Fire Department in cooperation with the Honolulu Police Department. As you heard Surgeon General Adams say, I do want to, you see all the blue lights and the yellow lights. I mean, we've got our first responders are all hands here doing the best they can. And I'm going to leave it up to them, but I think they're going to select it more often than not. It may not be every day because part of the goal here is to get testing in other places where testing has not been done. And Aloha Stadium is a great venue for a lot of people coming, but it's for the South Shore, right? The more urban part of the island. But what about the west side and Waimanalo and the North Shore and those places? We want to get there too. So we're going to try to do a balance, try to select 5 sites maybe at certain days, spread around. But Aloha Stadium is going to be in the mix and it's probably going to be a big part of the mix. So it's not. The inter-island quarantine is in effect for people leaving Oahu to go to the neighbor islands, but not for those coming here. And part of the reason is we have the caseload that concerns our neighbor island friends and family, and they want to make sure that you're quarantined if you leave Oahu to go there. It's not so much an issue here. So there have been discussions about how do you build hospital capacity. And as you know, we're watching closely to make sure we don't exceed the number of ICU rooms and just COVID-19 wards. And we watch it every day. And there's still a margin, there's still capacity there, but it's a concern. And so how do you build more capacity? We, the City and County of Honolulu, have offered to the hospitals the Blaisdell Arena or the Exhibition Hall as a place to add additional capacity, not so much for COVID-19, but other people in the hospital that could be relocated there, not really sick, and open up rooms in the hospital for those who are COVID-19 positive. The other thing, though, is as you know, Queens has reached out to see if perhaps Tripler would be available to move patients to, which is another opportunity. That's a better opportunity than building a field hospital, right, which is putting up tents and a lot of other things. I think it's better to distribute capacity among the hospitals on this island. So Tripler right now has capacity. Some of the other hospitals have. I know that Wahiwa, for example, has taken patients from Queens and relocated there. I think we should do that first, but we should keep an eye on do we need to put a hospital outside of a hospital. And I would prefer to have it at somewhere where it's covered, where you have air conditioning and restrooms and out in the field, out in an open with the sun.